main concepts what you have learned in the sexual reproduction of the flowering plants. Okay, so as the result of double fertilization, the end product is what? Zygote. Okay, so what is the number? Chromosomal number is, it is a triple fusion ploid, where you use the term primary endosperm nucleus. Primary endosperm nucleus. Okay, so as a result of double fertilization, zygote is formed. As a result of triple fusion, endosperm is formed. Okay, now what happens to the zygote? Zygote develops into an embryo. And then the heart-shaped embryo. And then the matured embryo. Okay, so these are the development what takes place after the formation of zygote. Okay, now what are the post-fertilization changes what you are going to learn here is, that is nothing but ovary develops into fruit. Ovary develops into fruit. Just remember the, recall the diagram, whatever, okay? Inside that you have this ovule, the microphyll, everything. Stalk, funicle, all those. Okay, this is the ovary. So this ovary develops into fruit, okay? And then this is the ovule. Ovule develops into seed. Ovule develops into seed. And then these are the integuments. Outer integument and the inner integuments, okay? So these integuments develop into zygote, okay? So outer integument and the inner integument, testa and the tegument, okay? Outer integument and the inner integument, it develops into testa, and one more layer is the tegument. So these are the layers of the, these are the nothing but seed coat. What do you call it as? Seed coat. So what is the name of the seed coat? Testa and tegument. Then what happens to the other part? Here, what is there? We have learned about the synergids, egg, and then these two polar nuclei, and here three antipodals. So all those will disintegrate. Okay, all the antipodals and the synergids will disintegrate. This zygote develops into an embryo, and here the polar nuclei, after triple fusion, it is converted into primary endosperm nucleus. I hope it's clear. After the fusion of male gamete and the female gamete, zygote is formed, which develops into embryo. Further development leads to globular embryo, heart-shaped embryo, and immature embryo. What about this? After the fusion of male gamete and the polar nuclei, you use the term primary endosperm nucleus, right? Okay. So here, what happens? Other than that, you have calyx, corolla, right? All those will shrivel and fall off. I hope it's clear. Ovary develops into fruit, ovule develops into seed, integuments develop into testa and tegument, calyx, corolla will shrivel and fall off. Okay, so these are the changes that takes place. Now what happens in some cases when you just look at it, this endosperm nucleus remains even after the development of the seed. Okay, this primary endosperm, what is the function of this pen? You use the term pen. Primary endosperm nucleus provides nourishment for the developing embryo. Okay, in some cases, just when you look, you call this endosperm as pre-nuclear endosperm. Pre-nuclear endosperm. Okay, now what happens? This endosperm, imagine this is the endosperm. Now it undergoes mitotic division. Okay. And then many nuclei are formed. It is on nuclei, all of you after fusion, okay? Many nuclei are formed. So here only karyokinesis take place. Okay, karyokinesis, only nuclear division take place. Okay, if cytokinesis also take place, then there will be cell wall formation. But here only karyokinesis take place. So the nuclei remain as it is. Very good example what you can remember here is about tender coconut. Okay, when you just open that coconut, you drink water, right, which is very nutritive. So that water, it is being formed from the free nuclei. Okay, there is no cell wall, so you use the term free nuclei. So the tender coconut, okay, after the free nuclear endosperm is formed, karyokinesis, free nuclei is formed. Okay, after that, what happens? Cytokinesis take place and cell wall formation is seen. Okay, so you call that to be cellular endosperm. after the cell wall formation, the term you call it as cellular endosperm. I hope the what is the heading is clear, cellular endosperm. So what is the cellular endosperm? When you just take the coconut, if you're going to remove that water, the white thing what you eat, right, coconut, that is nothing but the kernel, you call it as, right? So that is formed by the cellular endosperm. The liquid is formed from the prenuclear endosperm. The material, the thing what you eat, it is formed from the cellular endosperm. Can you understand now? Okay. So when you talk about the for development of seed, this primary endosperm nucleus helps in nourishment for the development of seed. So how does it help? In such case, even after the seed development, it remains. Okay, even after the seed development, it remains. Then you call that seeds to be albuminous seeds. Can you understand? Or endospermous seed. What happens after that? When the seed is formed, when the fruit is formed, okay, inside the fruit, what is there? Seed is there, right? Okay, so even after the development of seed, here, if the endosperm nucleus remain, in some cases, here there will be no endosperm nucleus. Fully it will be nourished, fully it will be washed off. Okay, so everything will be supplied for the development of the seed, right? Nothing will remain. Endosperm will not be there. In that case, you call it as non-albuminous seed. If endosperm is not there, you call that as non-albuminous seed, ex-endospermous seed anyway, okay? But if it remains even after the development, then you use the term endospermous or albuminous seeds. Can you understand the concept? Can you understand the concept? Very good example, you will be studying in, or you use the term persistent. Persistent, but it remains, endosperm remains even after the seed development. In what cases? It may be maize, it may be rice. Okay, all those examples, you can give it here. But non-albuminous seeds, here example, very good example you can learn about pea and groundnut. Peas, green peas and groundnut for non-albuminous seeds. I hope you understand. Let me tell you, primary endosperm nucleus supplies nourishment for the development of the zygote. Even after the embryo development, seed has developed. Okay, if the endosperm remains, if it is persistent, then you use the term albuminous seed or endospermous seed. If there is no endosperm remaining after the seed development, then you call it as non-albuminous. So one more thing, you would have, hope you remember, okay? So the same way, and the ovule, right? First class, I taught you about the nucellus. Do you remember? Nucellus, and from the nucellus, only one megaspore. So the other nucellus remaining. So this nucellus, if it remains, even after the development of the fruit, you call it as persistent nucellus. There I told you about persistent endosperm. Endosperm, it is seen after the triple fusion. Can you understand? Nucellus remains in the megasporangium. So if it remains even after all the development has taken place, you call it as persistent nucellus. So this persistent nucellus is given the name perisperm. What is the name given? Perisperm. I hope you understand. Listen, this is the nucellus, all those things. And from here only one functional, right? It carries divisions, meiotic division, and it forms megaspore tetrads, right? Okay, out of the three, it will disintegrate and only one remain as functional megaspore, which develops into a female gametocyte or gametophyte or embryo sac. Okay, so the other cells are called as nucellus. If it remains even after the development, you call it as persistent nucellus. The term given for this persistent nucellus is perisperm. Yes, okay. Now, what is the main function of the seed? Even after the seed dispersal take place, what is the viability? For how long it will be viable? For how long it will be alive, right? So when the seed is being dispersed, for some seeds, it may take 6 months. Some seeds are there. Example, very good example, lupine. You would have heard about the word lupine. That is a very good example. Lupinus arcticus. The species name is Lupinus arcticus, which lives in Arctic tundra. Arcticus, which lives in Arctic tundra region. Can you understand? Okay. So these are the species which is viable for many years. Even for thousands of years, it is viable. Can you understand? Even some species are there which is viable for 2000 years. Phoenix. So this is about 10,000. After 10,000 years also, it was able to develop into a plant and it has given flowers. It has flowered. 2000 year old seed, I'm talking, after the seed formation, after its dispersal, even after the dispersal, what happens? The water present inside the seed, it will become dry. So it may become dormant. You call it as dormant seed. It will be alive, but it remains silent. So when it starts germinating, when there is suitable temperature, when there is suitable pressure, water, all the favorable conditions are available, then the seeds come out of the dormancy period and it starts germinating. So likewise, one such very good example what you are going to learn here is lupine. That is nothing but the Lupinus apicus, which is found in Apic tundra. Even after 10,000, this is a 10,000-year-old seed which is being flowered. Okay, there is another species you call it as Phoenix. It's a date palm. Date palm. Okay, this was found near the Dead Sea, near Herod, King Herod Palace. Okay, so this is a very good example. What you have to remember, there is a phoenix, which is date palm, and this is Lupinus apicus, which is a lupine, right? So this is a very important question, board question, right? One mark question. So it is not that all the seeds are undergone dormancy only at the certain duration. We are talking about fruit. Fruit is developed from a fertilized ovary. Fertilized ovary develops into a fruit. Okay, and the fruit. Okay. Right? Simple fruits or simple fleshy fruits. Simple fruits, because you have fleshy fruits and dry fruits. Fleshy and dry. Okay. And here you have aggregate fruits. And next one is composite fruit. What is that? Composite fruits. Simple fruits, aggregate fruits, composite fruits. Okay. So simple fruit, a fruit which is formed from one ovary. A fruit which is formed from one ovary of one flower. Aggregate fruit is formed from many pistils of one flower. Many pistils of one flower. Can you understand? Here only one flower, one ovary develops into simple fruit. Here one flower, many pistils will be there. Many female reproductive part will be there. Okay, that will develop into an aggregate fruit. Can you understand? Okay, next one here is composite fruit. What is composite fruit? Multiple inflorescence. Can you understand? Many pistils. Okay, multiple. Example, you can imagine jackfruit. Jackfruit is a composite fruit. Yes? Okay, so these are the classification of fruits. Okay, now when you talk about here seed, there are two types, dicot seed and monocot seed. Dicot and monocot. What is dicot? Two cotyledon. What is dicot? Two cotyledon. What is the function of this cotyledon? It stores food. You would have learned it 10th. Do you remember? It stores food. What is the function of this cotyledon? It stores food. Now, the part which comes out above the ground, you call it as plumule. What do you call it as? Plumule. And which comes below the ground, plumule develops into shoot system, radicle develops into root system. Okay. And the attachment, here, this attachment, you call it to be epicotyl. What is this attachment? The connection between plumule and the cotyledon. Plumule and the cotyledon, you call it as epicotyl. The attachment between radical and cotyledon is called as hypocotyl. Can you understand? Dicotyledon, both are seen in angiospermic plants. Dicot, two cotyledon, which stores food. The part that comes out above the land, okay, above the ground, you call it as plumule. And the part which goes into the soil, you call it as radical. Radical develops into root system. Plumule develops into shoot system. And the attachment between plumule and cotyledon is epicotyl. Attachment between cotyledon and radical is hypocotyl. Okay, and this is the embryonal axis. This portion will be the embryonal axis. Okay, now but what happens in monocot? Instead of this cotyledon, here you have, right here, here you have a portion, you call that to be scutellum. This cotyledon in dicot is given the term scutellum, S-C-U-T-E-L-L-U-M, scutellum in monocot. Okay, then what happens here? The same way you have like this, this will be the plumule, okay, and this will be the radical. Now, what is the difference you are going to learn here is, here there will be a covering attached towards the plumule. You call this to be coleoptile. The terms are new, so when you go through again and again, you'll be able to recall the terms. Plumule covering, you call it as coleoptile, and radical covering is called as coleorhiza. Yes, okay. So listen, monocot, only one cotyledon. Mono is only one. Monocotyledon is only one cotyledon. Instead of cotyledon, you use the term scutellum, and the upper part which is going to develop is called as plumule, and here you call it as radical. Plumule has the protection called as coleoptile. So grass, everything. Okay, right. Here, peace. Right. Now, if the fruit, we have learned here, right? If it develops from a ovary, you call that to be a true fruit. What do you call it as? Because we have learned post-fertilization changes, ovary develops into fruit. So ovary, if it develops, you call it as true fruit. Otherwise, I taught you the structure. Do you remember? Thalamus or receptacle. I hope you remember the first day when I taught you. Thalamus or receptacle. Okay. If the fruit develops from the thalamus, you call it as false fruit. Example is apple. Apple is a false fruit. Okay. If the fruit develops without fertilization, then you use the term parthenocarpic fruits. What are they called as? Parthenocarpic fruits. Seedless fruits, otherwise called as. Or the mechanism, you call it as parthenocarpy. What is it called as? Parthenocarpy. Parthenocarpy means without fertilization. So if fertilization occurs, seeds will be inside the fruit. If fertilization does not occur, there will be no seeds. So what do you call this to be? Seedless fruits. Can you understand? So example for seedless fruits is grapes. Now what do you get in the shop? It's nothing but example grapes you would have found without seeds. So this is being produced artificially. Can you understand? Okay. Even now, scientists research is being going on how to introduce hybridization methods or how to bring in this parthenocarpy with the help of the hormones, right? So all those developments and research is being going on now, right? But here, when you just look at this ovary true fruit, what happens? Banana. Very good example. Banana you have studied, right? Banana. There is no seed. Banana does not develop from a seed. But how does it take place here? Vegetative propagation. Yes. Can you understand? It is not developing from a seed. Only through vegetative propagation, only from the under part of it. You would have seen the tree, right? Musa, right? So that is the main thing what you have to remember here. So this is a mechanism. You call it as parthenocarpy without fertilization. And the fruits that are formed are called as parthenocarpic fruits or seedless fruits. That is a very good example here is grapes, right? Okay. So by this, all the whole lesson is being completed. And
if you like this video, share and subscribe my YouTube channel. Follow me on Facebook and Instagram. And the link is available in the description box below. Thank you.